What do I remember about Dad's graduate students? Well, I guess I was pretty small at the time that he entertained his first students, which were folks like Art Hawkins, Bob McCabe, and Fran Hammerstrom. But I remembered as a youngster was that they used to have seminars over at our house on Van Hise Avenue, Madison.
It was such a small group. He never had more than three or four graduate students at a time.
And they'd get together and somebody would talk about their research, and there'd be a lot of questions, and they'd pass around some apples and cookies.
We were invited for dinner several times, and I went to seminars.
We knew them well. We were all contemporaries. We all went to Monday night seminars together. We entertained them in our house, usually at Thanksgiving or Christmas or weekends. The students came out to the shack very often with us and helped us in the planting and all of the shack activities.
I was always in and out of Leopold's office all the time. He was a fascinating person. He was very, very polite and very attentive. I was shy and scared to death of everything and everybody, I think. But when you talked to him, he looked you in the eye and you had this feeling he really cared what you had to say.
Very, very kind and very, very considerate of everybody. Interested in whatever anybody said, and I never felt that he was looking down on me because I was the youngest. He was just very, very courtly.
Everybody loved him that I know. I mean, he was kind of a gentleman of the old school, very polite, well-mannered.
What a gentleman he was. Does everybody say that? I think so.
And I loved Mrs. Leopold. I mean, she's such a motherly type. And then when we had our baby, she just thought that was just fantastic.
It was a very jovial crowd. I can remember sitting at the top of the stairs and watching, peeking around the banister, watching these folks operate. And they'd have a jolly old time and probably end up with about an hour and a half, 2 hours or so of science talking, and then they just have a good time.
He said, there are two things that interest me. One is the relationship of people to each other, and the other is the relationship of people to land.
The folks were working on topics which Dad had assigned them. I think Art Hawkins was the one that was working at Fable Grove.
It was a type of program that Leopold was especially interested in right from the very beginning in, of trying to get arrangement whereby landowners, the farmers, and the sportsmen, and other interested people would sort of team up to make wildlife and natural things part of their farming. His long suit was that he thought that the farmer was the most important person in the role of conservation of the future. And I don't know that he would be too happy with how far that has gone. He knew, he recognized that it was a real long-term to get land ethic at a point where people just thought of that as part of their day-to-day activity.
Bob McCabe was picking up on some research that I think had to do with pheasant habitat.
Bob McCabe was a very close friend of mine. I was in school when all of these people were going to graduate school. Yes, I knew them all very well. As far as McCabe is concerned, he was not only a good friend of mine, a hunting companion, but I think that he, as much as anybody else, really represented the point of view that my father represented.
Well, Bob and I were married that summer of 1941, and Bob was working out at Fable Grove, and he continued to do that. And I got a job in Madison at the working in the chemistry building in the office. And so I was, I got a room in Madison, and Bob came and got me weekends, and I went out to Fable Grove actually myself.
This is, you won't be able to get this. That's a funny one of Bob. That's the only one I have of Bob. He was acting mugging by his car. And he'd bring his girl Marie Stanfield out sometimes, the girl he married, and she'd help wipe dishes in the kitchen after dinner. Mother ran a regular restaurant, you might say, for summers.
But I didn't have any actual contact with Leopold until later that summer. And Bob was picking me up at the chemistry building, and I came out. He had a little black Ford because he had to have a car for field work. And he didn't have a bit of money, neither did his parents. But Mr. Leopold kindly offered to loan him $100 for the down payment on this little Ford coupe. And then Bob made monthly payments of $16.25 or something, and eventually paid Leopold back the $100. But of course it was a lifesaver for him. So he was picking me up in this little Ford coupe, and I crossed over the street and where Bob was waiting, and the door opened, and out jumped this man I didn't know, and who came up to me and said, stuck out his hand and said, "I'm Aldo Leopold." Well, I was very flustered. I just was to meet this man whom I heard so much about it, and I thought was just this giant of a person, you know, in personality and learning. And here he was, just a very medium size, not particularly good looking, balding, and very normal, but he was very pleasant, and he had a very nice voice and was very cordial. And of course that was my introduction to him, and we were going to take him home. So I sat in the middle and shook a little bit, I'm sure, as I was sitting next to this very important man, and found out in subsequent meetings that he was so gentlemanly, so kindly and polite, and also he had a way of being interested in anybody and directing his attention. So it was not just looking past me to talk to Bob, but he turned out to be a very personable man.
The main things I remember about the way Dad treated them was that he treated them as equals. I remember when I took a course from Dad that he treated us pretty much as folks that needed to be opened up, but that we knew a lot, we just had to think about it.
Of course, I took my father's course. I thought that his examinations were the most instructive and difficult examinations that I had ever experienced in all of my graduate and undergraduate work, because the final examination in the course when I took his course was he presented the student with a cross section of a road, a roadside area, a fence, a dead rabbit, and a red rock. I remember that very well. Now he said, "Tell me why the red rock is there. Why is the rabbit dead? What do you expect to be in this place next to the road?" It was a very interesting examination. So he tried to make you think ecologically about what it is you were looking at, which of course was his whole approach to the outdoors, was to look and see what you see and try to make some ecological sense out of it. Hell yes, I took his course, you bet.
It was very pleasant being in his lab or in the lecture, because he wouldn't just give a flat lecture. He actually would give a few slides and a few statements, and then he'd turn around and ask you a question. What do you think about such and such? Or what do you see in this slide here? And this was certainly true on field trips. He would ask the students, and when I was one too, to interpret what they saw right there, reading the landscape, which he was very, very good at. And so became my brothers and his students.
I think you just couldn't be around somebody with those ideas and live with somebody who had them rubbed off on him without being influenced.
I remember going on a field trip with Aldo Leopold, and I think at that time we had to park way up by the blacktop road and walk down, because I can remember him going down that road with a walking stick, and we were trailing way down to the prairie.
But I did go on a couple when they went up towards the prairie, and I remember walking along with them. And I remember one time he had Aldo Leopold had his daughter Estella with him, and we walked up towards the river. And I remember another time when he brought out Mrs. Leopold, and she was going to make plum wine, I think. She wanted to gather some of the plums on the farm. And I remember Grandpa kind of clearing his throat because nobody in our family drank wine, nor did we think of such a thing as making it. And so it was kind of funny. Nobody really cared. But I remember her sitting out on a stump under the plum trees, picking up plums and getting down her hands. And she was such a pretty woman.
And I don't remember what the field trip was about, but I remember Aldo Leopold walking with his walking stick down the road, heading up the gang.
And I remember one time Aldo Leopold was there, and they'd gone for a field trip out towards Farmer's Island, which was a little raised part in a marshy area going towards Lake Mills from our farm. And he came back, and he had his hat full of morel mushrooms, and he was so tickled that he had this big heaping hat of morel mushrooms. I remember walking through the dining room with the mushrooms.
This is a field trip, which they took to the Fabrice farm. To the left is Vivian Horn, Leopold's secretary. I'm sure this was a special treat for her because I think she rarely went on trips like this. I think she was kept busy in the office all the time. And Art Hawkins, and then Ann Wing and Leonard Wing. Leonard Wing was the student, and he had recently married Ann, and then Aldo Leopold with his... You can see by the clothes he has on, he looks a little more European or German outfit than the other people. It was quite a common thing for Leopold to go out to each student's area. But I think maybe unusual to take all those people with him. This was taken at the Fabrice farm at the Ashland area when Doug was a student.
The area that Dad was very... clearly an excellent spokesman in was dialogue with native farmers, the local farmers.
And of course, all of this would be brand new information to these farmers. They don't think they ever had any contact with a university professor working on wildlife management. I think that's all new to them. And I do remember that in some of Doug's writings, he mentioned the fact that Leopold was very, very good at talking to anybody from any walk of life and be very friendly. And the farmers down there thoroughly enjoyed talking to him.
I think it can be said that the worldwide interest now in the field of wildlife ecology had its beginnings there at the University of Wisconsin, Dad's little department. And if you were to read some of Bob McCabe's writing, you'll see that it was a minor element at the University of Wisconsin biology program, while Dad was given the title of animal research chairman for the University Arboretum. The emphasis was always on plants. McCabe makes this very clear, that he tried to get, you know, foot in the door there where the administration of the management and the restoration of the prairies and so forth, woods there, would be for wildlife management. But that was hard for him because the botanists really had the field, had the floor, as it were. So that's interesting. And apparently he took this with great grace and managed to, nevertheless, pull in these students from disparate areas, a farmer from Utah, a guy from California who was interested in forestry, Bob McCabe from, and Joe Hickey from New York, all motley crew, as it were, except they all became excellent wildlife ecologists through working with his program and research that he helped design.
It was just a fluke that he met another student at Beloit who said, there's something very exciting going on up at Madison because they have just hired Leopold. And it sounded very much like something Doug would be interested in. See, Doug was already ready to teach high school biology. So Doug just went up, called up, made an appointment. And Leopold must have liked him so much that he sent Doug to Fable Grove to talk to Art Hawkins. And then Leopold took Art Hawkins' recommendation that Doug should be a student.
I think it was in 1934 or 5 that he probably came to the farm. And it was at that time that Art Hawkins came, and soon after there was Bob McCabe and Lyle Soles and Doug Wade and then other graduate students.
It was spring, and I know that he saw he was taking a bath in one of the roadside ditches, and he swears that he saw a whooping crane flying over. And some ornithologists don't trust anything that anybody tells them. But there's no reason why it couldn't be a whooping crane. But anyway, the weather was warm enough that he's trying to take a bath in a roadside ditch. Doesn't sound very clean to me.
Well, Bob came as a graduate student in the fall of 1939, and he wanted to major in what he thought was, or get a graduate degree in what he said was conservation. And he went to register somewhere up in letters and science, I guess, or biology, zoology. And he was told that, very brusquely, that he better go over and talk to Leopold in the ag school. And he was very discouraged because he didn't think he belonged in the College of Agriculture. And he made his way over there, which was quite a ways, and found this old building. And he got in to talk to the professor, and they had quite a nice chat. And although Leopold took on very few students, it was a very small department, a single man, he agreed tentatively to take Bob on. And Bob went out and talked to a couple who were out in the office, and that turned out to be Fred and Fran Hammerstrom. And they talked to him and apparently were favorably impressed and gave their opinion to Leopold, and so Leopold agreed to take him on. Fred Hammerstrom told me later that he said to Leopold that he wondered who this guy was who looked like a baseball player.
I took his course, and you couldn't hardly get in the lecture room because there'd be people standing in the aisles that weren't registered for his course. He was very engaging and attracted the wide interest.
It's Wildlife 113, and I was a third-year student, and he offered this in the Wildlife Ecology Department. I think it was every spring. Wonderful course.
Leopold would teach. He was always afraid, I think, of not presenting stuff just exactly the way he wanted. So he always worked on lectures exactly from his notebook in front of him. But in the field, oh my, what a difference. There you just would go around and he'd say, oh, look at this, look at this, look at that, and so on. And he'd be a totally different character in the field, and we were very, very fond of him in the field. And in the seminars that we, both the botanists and the wildlife people attended, he was very open and very very careful in his, if he was criticizing, he'd be very careful to be sensitive that you would not like it. And so he would be very careful in his wording, for example. He was exceedingly friendly, and you always felt as if you were like family with him. And his family came along on some of the field trips, and we knew them very well.
The professor thought very, very highly of his students, and he was vitally interested in their lives. He wasn't pushy about it, but he kept track of what you were doing.
We used to leave the baby with my mother-in-law in Beloit and go up to, and I would go with Doug to the seminars. I think there were maybe one night every 2 weeks, but I'm not sure. But the year that we did live in Madison, we took the baby to the seminar one night. Doug insisted that I go, and at that time we not only didn't know any babysitters, but we didn't have any money anyway. We were living on $60 a month of the, that was the fellowship stipend. The office that Doug was in was right next to the seminar room. So Doug, and it had an old bureau, some bureau drawers in there. He took the drawer out, emptied it out, put the drawer on top of the chest. We put the baby in the drawer. And we were hoping she'd sleep all through the whole thing. And nobody knew she was there. And right in the middle of somebody's talk, this baby started wailing. And I never saw such an expression of surprise on Leopold's face in my life.
Well, he was probably the best teacher I ever had. I think that's partly because I was strongly interested in the subjects he was trying to teach, but also that his method was not saying, okay, you've got to learn this and this and this and this. He'd give you a description of a situation, a piece of land, and say, okay, now you tell me what you see on this land. This is this whole philosophy of reading the landscape that he promoted for so many years.
My family lived at home, all of us, when we were at the university, as well as going to grammar school. We lived at home and walked to the school four times a day. And I used to walk often with my father to the university. And one day, we were walking down Candle Street as we got down to the university, and my father said, did you ever notice where the prairie ended? I said, no. Well, he said, if you think of the big oak tree in front of the Stovalls, which is in the corner of Van Hise and Allen, and then he said, you go down to the next street, and then he named another tree that I knew very well, and he said, you see, that was the edge of the oak opening. And he said, this is not realized that the prairie ended here, and the forest started there. The oak openings could be very well picked out by the individual trees that you know very well. Very interesting.
I was rooming with a fellow from my hometown who I was in the ag school, and he took a class of Leopold's, which involved going out to Lake Mills to the Fayetteville Prairie for a field trip. And I was invited to go along by my roommate. I was kind of hesitant at first because I'd never met the man, and I wasn't too sure that professors wanted uninvited guests. So anyway, I went, and I met the professor, and I learned a very great deal. I thanked him for the opportunity to come along on his trip. He said I was entirely welcome, and that was it. Then sometime later, I began to think, well, if I can go to school and get a degree in the sort of thing I'm doing all the time myself anyway, that's where I want to be. So I went and scheduled a conference with him one day in late 1945, and he said, well, he looked at my scholastic record, which was not very good up to that point, and he said, well, get your grades up, and I think maybe we can find room for you. Well, that's the way it worked out.
Leopold was very, very generous about talking things over with his students. You know, when you only have just a few students like that, you could give them a lot of time, and I think maybe, I'm not sure, but they might have each had one session a week where they were would go over the work of what they were doing. And there was a great significance on each person's writings. And Doug was writing an article called Death is Upon Them, and it was published in Birdlore. It's the magazine of the Audubon Club before the Audubon magazine. They changed the name. Doug spent the whole winter writing this short article, and I think the influence that Leopold had on each person's writing was very profound. And he rewrote and rewrote and rewrote that.
He was a very realist type of person, and of course a good writer, and he was a great stimulator. I'm sure that my involvement in writing, when I got through high school, I wouldn't have ever even touched anything like this. But we didn't have any choice. We had the, and of course all these things had to be published because they were financed that way. If you didn't publish them, well, you might not get some coverage.
So I did a great major part of the writing. I did some of the analyses.
Well, what made this important is that this was the first publication on this kind of on these kind of organism, class of animals, birds, you could say, in 17 years. Leopold was responsible for that kind of a whole feeling and everything, and he had seminars most of the time, once a month. We'd meet up and somebody would give a presentation on what they were doing.
The one time that Doug was giving his drought study, the baby wasn't polite that time. He had a bunch of graphs up on the slide or blackboard or something, and he was getting all mixed up, and they were asking questions, and he got completely confused about what was above the norm and below the norm. And I was sitting on the front row, and there must have been some kind of expression on my face, and Leopold saw me, and he said, Dot, you come up and explain this. Well, for the shy little thing to get up there and get it all straight and tell everybody, I think Leopold got a huge kick out of that. I think he laughed more and was nicer to me after that. He thought that was funny.
I'm beginning to feel something like something of a dinosaur, since there aren't too many Leopold students left, you know.